Good afternoon to everyone. I'm delighted to welcome you. I apologize for our delay. This is our first hybrid presentation of these times. I'm Brenton Likes, the co-director of the Center for Human Rights and International Relations, and along with Dan Canstrom, who is on the webinar someplace else in the universe. I'm delighted to welcome you here, and most particularly to welcome James Ferreira Moura, who is a professor of Interdisciplinary Bachelor of Humanities Studies at the University of International Integration of the Afro-Brazilian, Lusophony, and also of a graduate program in psychology at the Federal University of Ceará, with apologies to all the Brazilians here for my Spanish-French accent rather than Portuguese. As I mentioned, James is a professor. He is here with us from Brazil this year. He's a Fulbright scholar and a visiting professor at the Center for Human Rights and International Justice. It's a delight for me as a community psychologist to welcome another community psychologist in our midst. He also coordinates a network of studies and challenges of poverty, discrimination, and resistance, which is a research, teaching, and university extension through direct actions with women and children living in poverty situations, developing actions focused on improving the lives of these populations in the region of Brazil. He has been developing his research, focusing on intersectional discrimination processes against people in poverty in both rural and urban communities. He studied the authoritarian construction of whiteness and the maintenance of racism, classism, and machismo with urban middle classes and local elites in rural contexts. And we all know how critically important it is to study these issues at this particular historical moment. We're delighted to be collaborating with him in a transnational project this year. Thank you, James, and thank all of you for joining us, and we look forward to the discussion.
Thank you, Brinton. Thank you for everyone here. I think Brinton present myself, then I need forward and talk about my first blessings and special thanks. First of all, I would like to say blessing of our ancestors of Exu and Logunede, good orishas of the Candomblé religion, Afro-Brazilian matrix, and special thanks it's for the Center for Human Rights and International Justice, Brinton, Tim, Bonnie. They received, they host me so well, and I think I'm so helped to stay here with you and trying to create these transnational dialogues. My partner, Natalia, I'm here because we divided our two care tasks because we have two kids, then it's like, it's tough times. But we're trying to quest daily the sexual, ideological, colonial division of labor. And I come from a working class family. So I'm grateful for the increased investments in higher education in Brazil that occurred until 2015 under the Works Party government. And I could only pursue my career as professor because I had access to research grants at undergraduate and graduate levels. Then I think I'm a son of these social policies in Brazil, and I'm here because of this. And finally, thank for the students da Universidade da Integração Internacional da Lusofonia Afro-Brasileira, the University of International Integration of the Afro-Brazilian Lusophony in Brazil, because they accept to share their knowledge and their Black, indigenous, working class, intersectional trajectories of resistance in Brazil. And I think it's an opportunity to know better this trajectory is here. And
Dan, I need to share with you some context related to the situation of the COVID-19 in Brazil. First of all, we have almost 214 million Brazilians. The majority of them are Black people. Brazil, it's a Black country. It's important to mention it. And we have almost 21 million infected. people there in Brazil, and almost 600,000 deaths. Then it's a huge number. We face this challenge because we understand that these consequences are related to the acts of our actual president, Bolsonaro, and the majority of deaths are with poor and black population. And we need to face these problems, understand it in a political and ideological action that has been performed by Bolsonaro. And the consequences of the COVID, we have an increasing of number of people in a situation of poverty. The hungry comes back to our reality in Brazil. And then we have a reality that the people need to face the COVID, but need to face the poverty situation. And we will see the violence that is structured in our country. Then I would like to contextualize the region that I come. I'm born in a city called Pacatuba. It is located in the northeast Brazil. It's important to mention that the people who live northeast are usually recognized by the people that live in the south and southwest region in Brazil as lazy, poor, less intelligent people. And it's important to say that the people that live in the south and southwest are people that live in welfare. It's a welfare region that we have in the country. But I'd like to share with you the map with the red and green parts. That this map represents how the cities voted in the last presidential election in Brazil. And the cities that were painted with the green color were the cities these cities voted in Bolsonaro. The cities that were painted with the red color, they were cities that voted in Haddad. It's the other candidate there. And then it's like, we think about how manage the situation and who could be understood that's like less intelligent or political, how these political attitudes could be understood. And in northeast Brazil, we have a state called Ceará. This state has its capital, a city called Fortaleza. In Fortaleza, we have almost 3 million people there. And the city that this research was developed is called Redenção. Redenção was the first city in Brazil to liberate the enslaved population in 1884. And we have in Redenção almost 35,000 people there. Then it's a small countryside city. We have some photos, pics of Redenção, of the center of the Redenção. There is a church, there's a kind of mountain. The environment, it's a drier environment. It's different of capitals or like big cities, yeah. This is the university that I work as professor in Brazil, the University for International Integration of the Afro-Brazilian Lusophony. This university was created in 2010. The idea of creation of this university was was done by the former president Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva. He thought that this university could be understood as a strategy for historical reparation, because in the core issue of this university is try to promote an Afrocentric perspective of knowledge, and we have relationships with the other Portuguese-speaking African countries. Then we received almost 1,200 African students that they come to Brazil and they study in this university. And then we have a powerful environment, an atmosphere with different perspectives of the world. But in these perspectives, this Afrocentric view is the basis of our relationships, knowledge, and attitudes. The majority of Brazilian students are Black too, and then we could see that this is a Black university too in Brazil. And talk about, and I'm gonna talk about the objective of this research, that I will present some preliminary results here. We have a general objective that is to analyze the relations between human rights and a chapter of violence in discourses of university students in Brazil and in the US. Based on the intersection of different identity marks, we will see what identity marks we will work with the students, and the specific objectives that is to describe how university students are studying in select parts of Brazil and of the United States, define human rights and violence vis-a-vis diverse identity groups, to understand the relationships the relations they make between identity marks and human rights, and to understand colonial and decolonial articulations implicit in the conceptions of human rights constructed by university students in Brazil and the United States. It's important to mention that we will develop these focus groups in the United States in this fall semester in 2021. Then we are handling this, and we try to organize this to happen here in this semester. The method, we have epistemological perspectives that we try to interrogate these dominant power patterns that dehumanize the majority of population, and this pattern is the basis of the science, and then we need to question this. We use the qualitative perspective, the qualitative methods. We will perform focus groups about conceptions of violence, human rights, violations, and reparations. In Brazil, we have some participants divided in different groups. These focus groups were conducted in the spring semester this year. We had focus groups, we facilitated focus groups with Brazilian white men. This is a focus groups, and another focus groups is with Brazilian white women. And then we followed the same structure with Brazilian Black men, Brazilian Black women, African Black men, African Black women, indigenous men and indigenous women. And we have a quilombola group. That quilombola are the people that we could call it as quilombolas. They are perceived as with a directly relation with the African descendants, that in the colonial system there were some Africans that face and fight against this colonial system, and they created new communities in this period that they build relations equally in horizontal perspectives, and these communities were hidden in this period because the colonizers tried to destroy these communities. And then we understand that there are some communities in Brazil that are called quilombos. Then these communities that were created in colonial period are called quilombos, and there are people that still live there, and we call it people that live in these quilombos as quilombolas. Then we have quilombolas men, quilombolas women, and the majority of them are Black people too. The common characteristics of the participants is that we have all of them are undergraduate students at University for International Integration of the Afro-Brazilian Lusophony, and the majority of students came from the most peripheral strata of the society, like working class family or poverty situation. We are planning to develop these focus groups with white men and white women here in the US, and Black men, Black women, Latin men, and Latin women, Latin blacks, Latino, Latina, no. The common characteristic is that they could be undergraduate students at Boston College. The analysis that we will develop and we have been developing is that the thematic narrative analysis, and we use critical before college to understand these structural patterns with personal trajectories, and to start our talk about human rights, I presented the Universal Declaration of Human Rights that was proclaimed in 1948, and we have as a first article, all human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights. They are endowed with reason and conscience and should act towards one another in the spirit of the brotherhood. Then we have our main article of this declaration, and I would like to understand if this declaration works for Brazilian population with the intersectional events that the groups that were part in this research. But before continuing, I'd like to invite you to do and try to break this colonial linear time that we usually have in this kind of presentations and seminars. Then I'd like to invite you, even in YouTube and when you are at home or if you are working, I try to stop. And I would like to invite you to close your eyes. I will put a song, then we will listen to a song, but I hope you follow my voice and the orientations that I will do. Then close your eyes, try to pay attention in your breath, and try to breathe in, breathe out. Try to pay attention and how your body is. If you need to shake some part of your body. And try to remember a moment in which one of your basic rights or needs has been violated. If you could remember, how was the sensation? How was the feeling that you had in this moment? Mm-hmm. And with this image, sensations, feelings, I invite you to try to connect, to create bondings with the image, sensations, feelings that will be presented in this seminar, that these codes of the Brazilians, Black, White, Indigenous, Quilombolas that I will present here, they are trajectories of lives. They are alive. Then I'd like to work to be as a bridge that connect these experiences with your experience that you have and you had. Then we live in a country that it's crossed with structural violence. Then this structural violence, it's part of our daily life. There is an ideological process of justification of these violent acts. And a Brazilian Black woman mentioned this process of violation. I remember a lot of shoes of Jacarezinho massacre. Many of those who died didn't have any crime in the courts. People associate favela residents as criminals, regardless of whether they are adults, adolescents, or children. It's like there's a process that impacts everyone there, and the majority of people that live in the favelas are Black people too.
We have a second article of the Declaration of Human Rights that everyone is entitled to all the rights and freedoms set forth in the Declaration without distinction of any kind, such as race, color, sex, language, religion, political or other opinion. But we have in Brazil people that are marked by socially constructed stigma as racism. The structure of violence can be conceived as a process of violation of human rights to life. It's understandable that conservative political agenda and neoliberal political system can intensify human rights violations in Brazil. And what happened here? Yeah, it's high. Okay. And I would like to, say a speech of a Black Brazilian man that. So, because we are Black, the police station, which we have here in neighborhood, does not serve as protection. It helps to violate our rights. It doesn't come to protect us. It comes precisely to destroy the Black body, right? It's like, it's a fact that every Black people there could feel this and could feel this sensation. And this intensification of violation could be understood with the intensification of discourses and speeches that Bolsonaro make and have made related to conservative, extremism, racist, and sexist agenda. For example, we have an increasing of deaths in Brazil, and the majority of deaths are with Black and poor people. And we have an increasing of civilians with firearms too, because he represents a policy of death there. And then we have this speech. Younger Black men of 14, 15, 16, 17 years of age are dying because they have lost the right to come and go. The state violates all kinds of human rights and nobody is doing anything. And why are there so much violence and violations in Brazil? We can understand that there is a relation between violence and coloniality, and there is a colonial normative pattern that bases as human worth of respect only because or only those individuals with hegemonic identity characteristics based on whiteness, heteronormative masculinity, and wealth. And then this colonial normative created the coloniality. And like coloniality is rooted in intersubjective producing hierarchies and historical violence. And these colonialities legitimize the genocide and discrimination of non-hegemonic population. Like Jishnu Men said, besides, there is still symbolic violence, as we can see from the catechizing ideologies imposed on us. With these ideologies, little by little, we are changing and replacing our cultures with other cultures. Then we have some of historical facts that impact this structural violence too. We have 2,300,000 indigenous people that were murdered during the colonized period. And it's like a huge genocide that happened there. And Brazilian indigenous men said that. You can see this indigenous denial from the very beginning of the colonization. What space do the colonizers and the indigenous people occupy in the society today? All the violence they have done to my people, all these atrocities that the colonizers brought, I'm assuming that they did to me. We live in the process of suburbanization, that is a historical process of suburbanization. And this violence, it's intersectional, like a Brazilian indigenous woman said. In the massacres, they killed the men and raped the women, turning women into reproductive slaves. Unfortunately, we have this tragic story to tell of how women participate in this violent transformation. Related to the slavery of indigenous population, we have a system of slavery. It started in 1532. We had almost 5 million Africans were transported, kidnapped to Brazil. Almost 700,000 Africans died on the ships during these kidnappings. And we are the last country that liberated the system of slavery in the world. Then it's like, it's so representative what the racist structure we are situated. And the Brazilian population, like indigenous men said, and the Brazilian population is already born out in this gigant colonial violence with the black slavery and indigenous slavery. And we had some whitening policies that started after the process of abolition. The empire created an immigration policies for white Europeans, and we had almost 5 million of Europeans, white Europeans that arrived and stayed in Brazil. The main regions that received these immigrants, white immigrants, are the South region and the Southwest region, that are the regions that are a little more prejudiced than others. And there is a myth of democracy, of the racial democracy in the country, like we live it together, there is a harmonious between us, but it's a fake, yeah? It's a myth, like a quilombola man said. The state will always be on the side of the rich and trying to exterminate the minorities. We don't access many of these universal rights. Today, we are quilombola communities that have little access to electricity, water, education, and health only outside the community. With this, we should understand that this violence should be addressed and comprehended in an intersectional lens. There is an interconnection of different identity marks, and there is access of domination, and the racism and sexism in Brazil are together, like La Gonzalez said. And an indigenous woman told about it. Racism is something very strong in us. It is sexist racism. It also weighs on us indigenous women. Each wig on our hair, on our body, on our speech, on our thoughts that try to be silenced. With this, we need to do some relations about these intersectional perspectives and try to quest how the human rights are conceived and created. And then indigenous women said, another important question is to how to address how these rights were created. Who participate in the creation of the laws that now govern the entire world practically? Who is inside the United Nations? Do you have indigenous and African population there? Do you have subaltern voices that suffer all these violations? And we need to create a critical conception of human rights. And this critical conception must address this violence in localized and intersectional manner and lens, like a Brazilian woman said. Usually, when I think about human rights, I have a reference that is Marielle, a Black woman who was fighting for human rights and was killed for fighting for human rights. She acted in favor of the peripheral people and the police, who also suffer many violations. The police that kills as the police that dies. And I know that it also depends on me to fight for my rights, as well as the rights of mine, of those close to me. But I feel hopeless. I feel tired as a Black woman. I live my life as a fight. I see only fighting, and there are times that I feel tired. I have been fighting my whole life. Then the Black indigenous and women populations in Brazil, they have never had the basic rights to live, to live, yeah? And we have a Black African woman that in my country, in Guinea-Bissau, after the creation of human rights, there was still colonization in Africa because human rights was created in 1948. In that year, Guinea-Bissau was under the colonizers. Guinea-Bissau only became independent in 1973. My question is the Universal Declaration for All, was it selective? Why we were the colonization in Africa and the dehumanization of African people at the Universal Declaration of Human Rights? Then it's necessary to move forward and question the coloniality present in this process of classification, like a Brazilian Black man said. I remember that the idea of Sankofa from the Akan people, they say that we have to go back and relearn, right? Go back in the past and relearn. There is a guy from the Black movement in Colombia too. He said that we have to take everything we have learned, forget, and learn again. He said that it's our goal. Everything is on step after another. It takes time for things to change. And reparation, it's a quest for justice with concrete efforts and initiatives to recover the historical memory. One of the ways is to eradicate racism. Education, it's a liberate practice, as Paulo Freire would say. It has to have an Afrocentric curriculum that respects the context and singularity of subjectives, of the subjects. With this, we act and walk to avoid falling into the alienation trap that is so strong nowadays. And through this approach, the colonial strategies of reparation could be produced with the localized knowledge. So I think we need to build an accessible discourse about human rights in the present and the future. It's also to bring the inconstancy of Exu in Candomblé. This orisha says that he has to act always in the present, in the future, thus changing the past. And this policy of reparation must be practiced daily. reparation, like the white Brazilian woman said, reparation must be done through education, because education allows to contest many things. The colonial education focuses on more human rights, it's necessary. And humanize the bodies of Black indigenous people. I have to affirm myself as indigenous woman. Everyone sees that I'm an indigenous woman. Still, one or another tries to deny this, deny that I'm an empowered indigenous woman, deny that I'm an indigenous woman who is in the academic space, deny that I can go far beyond this, even if I spend some time outside your village. I carry my essence, my culture, my ancestor with me. And to recognize the importance of the ancestors and the centrality of the body. In this context, the women were protagonists to prevent the silence from remain forever. In here, we have a feminine spirit, Kanyikaho. This feminine spirit, it's what brings us the strength and the voice of women. This spirit also brings us the security that we women are speaking and make our contributions through our experiences. Thus, one possibility of reparation is to ask them to preserve this silenced knowledge, to listen to this knowledge, to maintain the ancestral knowledge that governs us through our orality. And to stand against the colonial system and love among peers, like indigenous men, indigenous women said. As my grandmother used to say, I may die and not see this land demarcated and free, but I fight so that one day my great-grandchildren and great-great-grandchildren may see it. And I fight for other generations to have a land with freedom. My grandfather and my great-grandmother could not see it. I don't know if I will see this land accessible one day, but I fight so that others can at least live in this land. And recognize the importance of anti-colonial violence, like a Black Brazilian quilombola woman. So I think that the role of each person is to tension in this space so that rights of all human beings are respected. As a quilombola, we will fight for the right of human beings. Then for final considerations, we should understand that the basis of structural violence is the coloniality. And the human rights activists and scholars like us are challenged to reframe human rights through this intersectional lens informed by subalternized voices and try to dismantle this colonial and this coloniality that are part of our reality. Poverty and working class families and factors are factors in the human rights violations in all racial identities. And Black indigenous women have experienced more violations, but they presented more strategies of reparation too. The state, informed by population, pueblo, povo, is responsible for developing human rights collectively. And reparation should be grounded in the process of resistance of women, Black, and indigenous people. And the next steps is try to create these intersectional studies about these trajectories with these subjects and try to facilitate focus groups with white, Black, and Latin students here in the US and try to create these bridges that we could understand as transnational perspectives of human rights and try to understand transnational perspectives of reparation. Here are some references. This is the artist called Matheus Rips that produced the most of the paintings that are in the presentation. And thank you so much. Thank you. Let's share the screen together. We'll do collectively this.
Okay. Thank you, James, very, very much. We now have some time for questions, reflections, comments, and we'll take them from you all and also perhaps from the audience.
Yeah.
And if you would introduce yourself briefly when you ask your question, right, that would be wonderful. Mm-hmm. Or comment.
Yeah.
Don't have a question. Yes.
Yes.
Hi. Thank you so much for a wonderful presentation. I am an in-person lecturer. Well, my name is Daniela. I'm from Venezuela. I teach international rights to multiple persons. And well, with my practice, I think it's so interesting to the topic. My question is, you have considered or included all the Inter-American system of human rights in your research.
Mm-hmm.
I think the Inter-American system of human rights has a robust legal framework that protects against racism. Is the Inter-American Convention of Human Rights against racism, also of course the American Convention of Human Rights, and also gives special protection to vulnerable populations, no? Mm-hmm. And of the theory of intersectionality.
Yeah.
And especially, I was thinking especially in preparation, no?
Yeah.
You included some very important possible reparation, as symbolic reparation, historical reparation, and one of the main contributions probably of the jurisprudence of the Inter-American Court of Human Rights and the doctrine of the Inter-American Commission has been focused in reparation.
Yeah.
So I'm going to repeat the question briefly for the audience that's on the webinar. But Daniela Rosa from the law school is asked a question as to whether or not James has considered the Inter-American system of human rights as a resource, and particularly mm-hmm. thinking about marginalized or vulnerable communities and the framework of intersectionality, as well as your focus on reparations. Thank mm-hmm. you, Daniela.
Thank you. And Daniela, I think the Latin American perspectives, it's like it's so important to understand these violations. Because when we understand that we are part of the South globe, when we're part of the global South, it's like we are like brothers of violence and historical facts that decolonization, it's central for our reality as Latin Americans. Yeah. And then I think it's a guide that we need to follow and try to understand that even in Latin American perspectives could maintain some racist structure of our societies. Because I'm talking about, for example, the progressive movements in Brazil that talk about human rights, but there's sometimes they could forget specific populations, and I could say more indigenous population. And it's the intersection between race and gender, because I think it's the core of our issue. And thank you for this idea that we can make connections with the Inter-American perspective of human rights. It's amazing.
And you two can make connections.
Yeah.
Through the law school.
Sure. Yeah, definitely. And you.
Another comment or question, reflection? Yes.
Hi, I'm Kimberly Wesley. I'm from the National Program. I would like to know more about there was something on the slide that says reparation is grounded in the existence of Black women. And you mentioned like a lot of the folks, a lot of Black women that they were fired and going to be, I almost feel like it's such like a burden on Black women that they're carrying so much weight. I wondered if you could talk more about what you mean exactly.
So this is a question from Kimberly, who works in the area of counseling, and she was drawn particularly to one of the quotes from Afro-Brazilian women and mm-hmm. the burden on Black women in resistance and also in the reparations process. Mm-hmm. And can you comment a little more specifically mm-hmm. about what you meant and what you've heard from the women with whom you've worked?
Amazing. Thank you, Kimberly. Thank you for sharing the thoughts. And I think we need to understand that resistance is historical. Like indigenous women said that they were warriors. They were fighters against the colonized, this colonial system. And then I think it's understand that with the racism and sexist and the heteropatriarchal structure of the society, the Black women, like Lelia Gonzalez said, could be understood as the principal group that could be violated and is violated because of this racist and sexist structure. But you survive. When we talk about Marielle, we mentioned that Marielle alive. Marielle is present here. We know that Marielle was killed. But we know that Marielle represents an effort to fight against the system. And the Black women have historically fought against the system. And then it's like there is historical and resistance that Black women did and have performed. It's like when you survive in a system that it's perpetrated so many violence, you are a warrior. You get to do it. But I know, like a Black woman said, you feel tired because it's a lot of weight that you need to handle and manage and overwhelm it. And try to understand how create possibilities of mental health that they could get it and try to strengthen this movement and try to become more visible. It's visualized that this happened now, because what happened, it could be, there is historical resistance, but a lot of, I think the most moments, these resistance are only related to Black women that are living. Then I try to share this knowledge and try to become this knowledge come as possibilities of changing. But I know that it's a big structure of the society that perpetrates this violence. It's like a huge step to change it.
I would like to just add one quick thing to this, thinking of a colleague and co-author that I've worked with, a Maya Quiche woman in Guatemala, who's been part of an organization called the Women of Kakala. And they are integrating what they understand to be healing processes with the political organizing activities in which they're involved. And some of those draw on, as James was talking about, some of the traditional beliefs as they've rearticulated themselves in contemporary society. But they also critique in their reflective processes these notions of resilience mm-hmm. and these notions that they feel have tempted Euro-North American psychologists in particular to assume that women who are marginalized, who are oppressed, men who are marginalized and oppressed can be resilient. And therefore the framing, if we also think of some Canadian American scholars who urge us not to focus only on the suffering, but recognize the complexities and the diversities of people's lives. So I appreciate also your comment about mm-hmm. psychosocial well-being or yeah. healing processes. And I think that some of the ideas from some of the Indigenous participants are helpful in, yeah. in thinking about that. Comment, yes.
So I have two questions. One is here around one of the participants stated that police that killed is the police that died. Trying to get your pretty good idea about this. Mm-hmm. And then also, when you talk about reparations, and we talk about structural violence, and I wanted to know your thoughts about a lot of participants who talk about Well, they said that the poverty and working class is kind of something that keeps back how the IP process, but a lot of their suggestions for reparations were centered on education and not so much on dismantling some of the structural systems that are twisted that enforces and upholds the colonizing processes historically. So I want to
thank you. So this question is from Professor Robert Motley, who's a professor in the School of Social Work and is particularly focused on police violence and the impact of police violence in the United States, particularly on youth and emerging adults. And he has two questions. The first having to do with some of the statements made by some of the participants about police who have been killed, and James will address that. And then the second one has to do with the focus in many of the statements of the participants around reparations having to do with education and the potential contribution of education, but not as much as dismantling the systems and structures that mm-hmm. hold in place the colonization processes that yeah. you've described in Brazil. So,
super. So. Thank you, Robert, for your consideration questions. When we think about the police, it's thinking about our country, the majority of population are Black. Then we have in the police like men Black police officers, like the police is Black too. And then the same police that kill like Black youth population, it's the police that it's the center, they are the target like for the our social problems, like the drug dealer, the drug traffic, and like the violence, because we have a violent sociability, like we have a structure of violence. Then there are several cases that policemen, police officers are killed too. Then, for example, Marielle represents these families that had members of their families. They work for the police and they were murdered because the process, it's not a police, but a policy. It's a social policy of death there. Like Demi Bem said, it's a society based on the deaths and based on the deaths of Black people because of the colonization process. And then here I have been living a few days in the United States. But I see that the majority of police are, for me, are white. Then it's like I think we have a different structure of society because, for example, Brazil, we have Salvador. Salvador is the most city that the most have Black population outside Africa. Then we have a racial structure of the society, and this the police, yeah, it's affected of this racist structure. And the majority of police are working class families too. They are not rich people. They are like low income middle class. They suffer the struggles of the working class families, and they really become a target. They need to hide these dressers and how they handle like police officers, because they are targets of possible violations as a police officer. And try to understand that these focus groups, I think they represent undergraduate students. And I think they gave ideas about possibilities of education. I understand that the process of reparation, it's deeper to repair this structural violence. And I think they gave us ideas that we need to be patient to the big chance. Like Paulo Freire said that we need to have an historical patience for big chance in the society. And there are some discourses and speeches that they made that we need to fight today. We need to change our reality today in a coloniality perspective, because this process of colonization impacted us in an intersubjective perspective. Then it's, we need to reframe our overview of the life of the society. Then I think they gave us more this intersubjective perspectives of reparation that are related to the education contexts. But I understand that we need to move forward and create more concrete process of reparation that could be like transnational, national, could be broader, because I think the changes could be broader too.
It's a very interesting question, and your reflections are really important because it also raises another dimension of context,
yeah,
in terms of who the participants are and what the stretch of what they might be preoccupied with,
yeah,
in light of that specificity of the context.
So yeah,
I appreciate that. Yes.
I am Jessica. I'm also from Brazil. I'm a Fulbright scholar as well, but yeah, based on the Museum of Science. And I also work with the Declaration of Human Rights, but according to the right of science and culture, and also for people with disabilities. So my question for you, James, is if you have data on people with disabilities in these focus groups, because we know that when we are talking about disability,
yeah,
this is another layer that worsens the exclusion.
Totally. Yeah.
So, and if you are thinking about adding this other group that has a lot to do, many people are also poor, are also black, are also
yes,
human, etc. in your study, or if you can do something like that, because we have a lot to do, and yeah, they also are excluded and,
yeah,
and are part of this whole context of intersectionality and,
yeah,
exclusion and violation of their rights.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. This is a question from Jessica, another Fulbright scholar, also from Brazil, who's working affiliated with the Museum of Science here, and also working with the Declaration on Human Rights, with a particular focus on the rights to science and also on the rights of those people with diverse abilities. And the question has to do with whether or not in the focus groups you were able to incorporate this intersectional in some way, or have you given thought to including it in future work? Thank you.
Thank you, Jessica. I think we needed to make choices when we prepare this research, but I think I had an overview of Brazil related to discapacities. We have at University of International Integration of the Afro-Brazilian Lusophony, we have 5,000 undergrad students. And we can count in our hand the quantity of students that have some discapacity. Then I think it's a problem before this research that the people with discapacity, they haven't had opportunities to access the higher education in Brazil,
even education,
because we are a society, I think, ability able center. Yeah, it's like I think if we have struggles for this population and thinking about intersectional perspective for a disabled people, it's like I think it's a huge lack of opportunities, and the violence that they have to face daily, it's gigantic. Then we had a first problem of our society, because they don't access the undergraduate, the universities in Brazil. Yeah, and I think it's because they don't appear here. It's like Brinto said that we could think about sexuality like the homophobia, and there are some students that suffer homophobia in an intersectional lens of sexuality. And it's interesting that it is a identity mark that's cross, like everyone, like there are, for example, Black men, white women, indigenous men that could talk about sexuality, because it's a mark that it's a cross mark, yeah, it's a cross identity mark. But because this capacity, we had like, I think, a major problem there.
I really appreciate you raising that also, because it is unfortunately also within the United States, a typically marginalized intersection in the midst of many of these studies. We know many of you have other commitments for this afternoon, but we thank you very much for being with us, and we thank those of you who have been online. I also would like to invite you to help yourselves to lunch and to bring one to one of your friends, since the number of people who, that are here in person are smaller than the ones who RSVP'd. So thank you, James. And James will be here for the semester. So please look for him in Stokes Hall or through the internet. He's in the Center for Human Rights.
Totally. Thank you. Bye-bye, people.